Okay, so we will start and people will start joining us. And then, well, welcome everybody for this very, very interesting session here on the Networking Fridays. We have a fantastic panel with a lot of very interesting people, including young students and I hope future scientists linked to the ocean in the future. And so this is a very interesting, let's say, Networking Friday, because put together scientists and young students all over the Atlantic to discuss several aspects that will be presented later in this session. So we have Francisco Campuzano, Cassie Stimias, Kieran Kelly, Carlos Barreira, Paulo Oliveira, Teresa Oliveira, Anes Turpo, and also BB Kale. I mean, there's a lot of people, but we have to start. We have a very long agenda. So without any further ado, I will pass the floor to Francisco Campuzano. He's the guy behind this meeting. He made it all happen. I'm very happy that, we are having this session here today. And then this session will be available on the internet. If you have any questions, please write your questions in the Q&A box, not in the chat box, because it'll be easier for us to read and to reply. And this is a very open and relaxed conversation. So we have plenty of time. Some of you already participated in these sessions, like Carlos Barreira, very relaxed. We basically have 10 to 15 minutes, but don't pay attention to that. Just let it flow, okay? So, hello. So, Francisco, please start. Maybe you should present the project, say some words, and then we will continue.
Okay, thank you, Jose, and thank you for having us here and for inviting us. It's a very interesting event, in my opinion, and also in a very interesting week, because we are celebrating here in Lisbon now the UN Oceans Conference. So I think that this is a very good timing for having this session. And then I will introduce this project has some literacy part and education part for the general public, but it's a more complex project. So I will try to give an overview and what are the type of things that we've been doing in the project and for communication with the general public, for trying to integrate the general public. And also then there will be I will give the floor to the partners and the friends that we made in the way of this activity with the miniboat. So I will try to share my screen. Are you able to see in full screen? Can you confirm this?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Okay. So then I will start. So this is a project that is named iFADO. That is a project that is funded by the INTERREG Atlantic Area. And I will show you here some of the slides. So this is called Innovation in the Framework of the Atlantic Deep Ocean. Because we had the feeling and the difficulty of how we were going to implement a directive that is very important in the European Union, that is called the Marine Strategy Framework Directive. And you can see here in the image the Atlantic area of this Marine Strategy Framework Directive. So these are the exclusive economic zones for the countries involved in this project in the Atlantic area. So we have five countries, which are France, Ireland, Portugal, Spain, and the United Kingdom. And we found that it's a very vast ocean to be monitored. And then we have to, scientists and policymakers, we have to be able to say if the status of the ocean is good or not. So it's a very large area to cover. As it said in the slide, it's 24% of the total EU waters, and only 12% of the population living in this coastal area. And we are only talking about surface, because then the ocean here is quite deep. So we have some challenges to face here. Due to COVID, this project have extended from the original 4 years to 6 years. And then we already have now an extension with new activities that made that the overall budget goes from up to 4.2 million euros. So, and we have 21 partners, 12 are full partners and 9 associated partners. I'm going to show you afterwards who is the partners of this project. So as I said, the idea is to try to contribute to the competent authorities to implement the Marine Strategy Framework Directive, try to provide tools to optimize the observing strategy and try to coordinate how different countries monitor and when they monitor. Try to provide services at regional and local scales to enhance the blue economy and to contribute to the challenges posed by climate change. And then capitalize on individual initiatives and historical data from the European Atlantic region perspective. So there have been many activities and there are many institutions collecting data, doing models, doing a lot of research, but not so well coordinated according to what the next country is doing. So, I mean, we are trying to contribute for this coordination and cooperation. So here you can see this color picture also, what are the descriptors of the marine strategy, but I won't go into detail about that. So we are going to cover only a few of them because it's a very vast piece of legislation. So these are the full partners. Okay, so we have like 12 full partners. So these are partners that are actually doing some research and some practical work. So we have, these are in blue, is the regions which are included in Interreg Atlantic Area in the program as it is now, that is closing next year. You can see that we have partners from all the area, the five different countries, and also from the three archipelagos that are included. That is the Canary Island, Azores, and Madeira. So we have partners, technical partners, in every one of these regions that they are coordinated and try to do things together. Then we have the associated partner that are the institution responsible for the implementation of the marine strategy. So are the policymakers. And this is, that's why I said it's interesting to do it during this week because of the UN Oceans Conference in Lisbon that is trying to put scientists and policymakers together. So in this project, we have all of them and try to coordinate and also try to deliver products that are useful for them. So this is the diagram that we have as an image. What are the pieces of research and the kind of institution they want to put together? So we want to work with government, academia, industry, and citizens. So all together, because the responsibility for having a healthy ocean we all have to collaborate and to contribute for this to happen and to be involved. So the academia, the main partner that we have here, the industry, we are trying to incorporate them by signing MOUs and try to use some of their devices and some of their discoveries in our project, and also trying to link with some European or global institutions like Eurobus, ISIS, or the OSPAR Commission. And then this event of today is more focused on how we try to incorporate citizens. So then we have some work that we did with Pine of Science, also promoting apps for monitoring, and also educational passages, that is our main objective of this session. So we are also doing, just to give you some background, what are the technical work that we are doing. We try also to collaborate between the different research fields, because sometimes we try to aggregate also with our peers and not to talk with other researchers that do work in a different field. So we try to put together people working with in situ observation, traditional monitoring, also with remote sensing, novel technologies like LIDARs or Argo floats or different type of technology, and also numerical models. I myself am a numerical modeler. But we try to talk to each other and try also to see how we can integrate all this information together. Okay, so just to give you a brief overview of what we have achieved or what we have done. Like for the traditional monitoring, we managed to have like 42 international participation in research cruises. That means people from one institution going to in cruises of another institution from another country, sharing methods, sharing people, sharing samples. So by doing this, we are able to try to cover this very vast area of the Atlantic Ocean. Then we are also doing with remote sensing, we can go from global scale with satellite Earth observation to local scale where we can have some products with up to 10 meter resolution. And then this can contribute to indicators that they will support the descriptors of this directive. Then also we have numerical models where we use global models, but also we do downscaling to specific areas where we try then to study local scale, regional scale, and also Atlantic scale. So, and then just to show you here, also you can see some of the novel technology that we've been using. Like this is an endurance line that has been established with our colleagues of PROCAN that they are today here, and also with the support of the Hydrographic Institute from Portugal. So we are using, we are doing this mission with a profiling LiDAR every year since the beginning of the project. So, and then we can provide this very long time series on the vertical that they go across from Nazaré Canyon in Portugal to the Canary Island. So this is some of the properties that we can observe, like temperature, salinity, and chlorophyll A. And then you can see the full transit. But we have done many. We have done like 8 international glider missions. This is one of them. We have released a wave glider from the Azores up to the Canaries. We have done an out-and-out mission around the UK and Ireland. And we are still planning a very ambitious one for being done during this year that will go from Ireland up to the Canaries, trying to cover all the Atlantic area. So, and then we took the opportunity to try to show some of this equipment to the kids, because I think that it was very interesting to have them and to touch them and be next to it. So this is one of our last meeting in person that we had in the Azores. And then we invite one school to come and to see and touch one of the gliders that we were going to deploy. And then they were very, very interested, and they even left some messages like, taking me to the end of the world, please, and come back soon. I mean, they were very excited with it. So it was a very nice event. Then we are also doing some promotion of apps. We decided not to make another app, but to try to look on the amount of apps that exist already on the market and try to see which of them could contribute more for the MSFD and try to promote them. So we made this banner with a QR code where people using Android or Mac, they can go and download and try to collect some data. So there are some apps for watercolor, for knowing what is the depth or visible depth, also for marine litter. And then we were doing some activities in bars that was kind of for the original plan of the project. Trying to go to the citizens to meet them where they are and to do presentations in the bar as part of a program that exists, an international program called Pint of Science. We also organize, this is organized worldwide in a particular period of the year, but outside of this period, we also organize other symposiums when we were meeting and when we were doing some meetings all together, so we take the opportunity to go and to try to talk to the general public about it. And then we go to this event that we are doing now with the mini boats with educational passages. Then we decided to try to have, because of COVID, we were limited to go try to meet the people in person. That was very complicated. So then we decided to adapt from this situation, and then we had some previous experience with educational passages because some of the boats that were released in the US were arriving to Portugal. So then we knew about this program, we collaborated with them before. So then we thought that it was a good idea that we could take on with the communication activities and to involve the citizens. And then we decided to have one boat in every country of the Atlantic area. In the case of Spain and the Canary Islands, they released two, but at least one boat per country. So these are the institutions that were participating. These are partners from the project. So Marine Institute involved with one local school in Ireland, and NOC did the same in the UK, Paul Mer did the same in France, IPMA in Portugal, and Plocan in Spain. And then we coordinate with educational passages, and we try to set up this mini fleet that you will, this is the main activity that you will hear about today. This is, what is it today? I mean, what is the status of the mini fleet? So most of them, they have been released. There is only one left. And you will hear about the particular story of each of them in the next presentations. We already have done some communications between and some events between the different schools participating. And that was a very nice event, because also it was good to try to generate this Atlantic conscience and try to put people from different schools to talk to each other. That's it. That hope that I have managed to give you a brief overview of what are the objectives of the project and what other activities in terms of involving citizens we have done. And then I give the floor to our colleagues that they will introduce, and they will present each of the mini boat stories that and all the friends that we made in the way. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Francisco. Thank you very, very much. So we will now start. Let me go here. We'll start now with these stories with Cassie Steinies from Educational Passages. And please, Cassie, introduce yourself and tell your story. Yeah.
Hi, everyone. I'm Cassie Steinmist. I'm the Executive Director of Educational Passages. And I will tell you my story, our story. Educational Passages is a nonprofit organization. We're based in the United States. Our mission is to connect people around the world to the ocean and each other to inspire ocean stewardship through unique global experiences. Our key to success is helping people make their personal connection with the ocean, which is the essential ocean literacy concept. The idea started in 2008 to send small, uncrewed miniature sailboats across the ocean with a GPS tracker, and has grown into a global interdisciplinary science-backed ocean literacy program. It's comprehensive and adaptable, with many entry points and tools available for all to join in. Miniboats sail with the wind and currents, and because of the onboard transmitter, we can monitor exactly how they're getting there, providing a new way of looking at the message in a bottle concept. As I said, anyone can participate in the program, whether you build, decorate, launch, track, recover, or repair a boat. Like any boat voyage, it starts with a captain and crew. Sometimes this is in a classroom and sometimes not. It starts with a kit with all the supplies included in a 6-foot long box. We work with the teacher one-on-one to train, customize, and implement each program. We include comprehensive instructions and student workbooks that help the educator to focus on their curriculum, while the resources help guide the students to prepare their boat. It's completely student-driven with 7 teams, and there's 6 teams without a tech team, which is the sensor integration, and we'll talk about that in a second. The boats are built by the students and then set to sea by researchers, fishermen, cargo ship crews, etc. Community members are encouraged to join the building process the whole time, and speakers invited to talk about their work, which we've been doing with the iFADO project. This is not only a learning opportunity for knowledge, but for awareness and exposure of careers that they could one day be interested in pursuing. With recent data system upgrades, we're also working to make it easier for all the data to be downloaded so you can analyze it and access the boat tracks and sensor data. Our goal is to connect students with scientists and innovative companies to make more connections and develop skills and competence, but to also make our data available so it can be used for research, forecasts, and more. Program not only connects students with each other, but also with their community, their country, and the world, because if the boats land, the sticker on the deck suggests that the finder bring the boat to a nearby classroom. Each boat is truly special and has a unique story to tell. Most have multiple voyages. The idea is to keep the boat sailing and continuing to connect people as much as possible and for as long as we can. They're recovered, repaired, relaunched over and over again. And this helps to strengthen our connection and foster more ocean literacy and stewardship. This is just a snapshot from a couple years ago of all the boats at sea. As each boat has that GPS transmitter, we can share that track and story on our website so everyone can follow along. We've helped to set 177 mini boats to sea so far. While most were launched in the Atlantic, we've expanded the program to the Pacific, Indian, and even Great Lakes. Our boats have landed in at least 29 countries that we know of, reached 4 out of 5 ocean basins and 6 out of 7 continents so far. We've logged over 1.5 million kilometers by GPS with these boats. And recent developments and new designs are now allowing us to add sensor packages to the boats to increase data collection for both science needs and additional learning opportunities. So we're partnering with a group called MakerBuoy, which is an open source drifter company who modified their sensor pack to fit in the cargo hold on the miniboat. These new sensor packages are allowing us to take a deeper dive with students as each data set is a new learning opportunity. You know, the message in a bottle will tell us start and sometimes finish, but the GPS tells us exactly how it's getting there. Seeing those reports on a map shows us how it gets there and what it traveled through. Then exploring that track with our path analysis tool helps us to see what the winds and currents were and how they were pushing that boat along. Adding sensor packages are now telling us how the temperature of air and water are changing, how the boat is moving with pitch readings, and new cameras on the deck are literally showing us what the ocean is like as the boats are sailing. But the purpose is twofold because the data are also useful for all of us to learn more about how the ocean is moving and changing. As the miniboats are a unique vessel capturing wind and current, we want to maximize that space in the cargo hold to include as many sensors as we can to be helpful for science. So these sensors combined with online tools that allow us to explore models, forecasts, and nearby data around the miniboats creates an incredible and unparalleled educational experience. And that's a picture of the sensor pack showing that added data layer that you get more frequent reports, more data. This is a slide showing the story of the Rye Riptide's epic miniboat project, as we call it. Starting back in 2018, we worked with a school in New Hampshire here in the USA to build a boat. They finished building it just before COVID came, and then they were all sent home. But we found a way to overcome this by staying connected virtually. They sent their decorations over mail and email, and I applied them to the deck because I happen to live in New Hampshire. The boat was launched in October of 2020, but stopped reporting in September of 2021. 4 months later though, and the boat, well, at least the deck part, reported once more from a small island in Norway. The story was picked up by the media and shared very widely. The students then became ambassadors for the project, for the program, and for sharing about how the ocean connects us all, because they were learning about how that boat got there, why did it travel there. It was really great. These students studied everything from ocean currents to historical explorers during the program, and that's what we like to see. There are many curriculum integrations that can be made, not just for science and technology. We also make sure to include resources for educators that are aligned with standards so they can implement it in the classroom easier. The program is sound in promoting ocean literacy and helps us to build confidence and skills for all who participate. So another big key to success to this program lies in our partnerships and collaborations. The mini boats themselves are a tool and platform for so many learning opportunities, and we've really enjoyed working with organizations to help them make connections of their work to the students and participants. So today, the iFADO project is the one that we're highlighting. It's been such a great pleasure to work with everybody on this team here today and to see it all culminate to this event, helping to share their research, strengthen those connections around the Atlantic. I've had the pleasure of working with some great people, meeting fantastic students, and learning more about the Atlantic Ocean that connects us all. So I think you had already showed the slide of where the boats started and where they are. But as we say, there's the meme, this is how it started, this is how it's going. So next you'll hear the stories of each of these adventures and what we've all learned along the way. But there are dozens of other mini boats also at sea right now, and everyone can follow along. We've already had 20 launches this year, and it's only July. We've also had a few landings, so we hope you will follow along with us. We also started a new podcast, and there are many ways of getting involved. So we hope together we can inspire more students, support educators, connect communities, and contribute to science together. Thanks so much for having us here today.
So thank you, Cassie. Fascinating presentation, very inspiring project. And so now we will follow the boats, is that correct? I'll pass the floor to Kieran Riley and Peter Kane. Okay, good, we are ready. So please, the floor is yours. Can you introduce yourselves and then continue the presentation?
I can start off. My name is Kieran Riley from the Marine Institute in Ireland.
Hi, my name is Peter Kane. I'm a primary school teacher from Galway in Ireland. This is our first day of our school holidays, so I'm by myself. Students are all probably in bed at this moment, so good rest.
Okay, thanks, Peter, and thanks for the great introductions to Cassie and Francisco. So today, myself and Peter will be talking about the story of the Seoltar na Gcaillimhe mini boat, or the Galway sailor. So Seoltar na Gcaillimhe is the Irish for Galway sailor. So this started off with them. I'm trying to move the slides. Oh yeah, so we got our kit from Cassie in the Educational Passages program in 2020. And the construction then of the Irish iFADO mini boat took place in April of last year. So the majority of the assembly work was done by the Marine Institute team member Felicity Donnelly and her family. And you can see here in the photos, her husband Pat is preparing the mini boat. So this involved ballasting the keel, sanding the keel and the hull, and then attaching and installing the keel then to the hull. So a lot of this was done then throughout a couple of weeks in April. The next step then was to hand over the mini boat to the Kilglass National School, which is the school that Peter's from in Haskerah in County Galway. So Peter came to collect the mini boat in April. He called out to the Marine Institute on the 30th of April in 2021. And you can see here Peter in the right of the photo. In the middle there, it's Conal O'Malley, who was the chief scientist on the Aimshire cruise, which I'll talk a little bit about as well, and myself. Conal there is discussing the upcoming Aimshire cruise, which we deployed the mini boat from, and just gave some general information to Peter on the boat. And we also provided Peter with some paints to decorate the mini boat and the sails. So I'll hand over to Peter now, who'll talk a little bit about their experience then with the school of decorating and naming the Galway Sailor.
Yeah, good morning, everybody. Initially heard we were getting the boat, it was great excitement. We had just been through a lockdown period in school, so we came back at Easter time. So it was a great thrill to actually start the project. It was a perfect post COVID tonic for the school, for myself as a teacher and for all the children. So we initially I picked it up in April, we brought it out to the school, we got the paints, and then we had a couple of competitions. First competition was to name the boat. And we had a whole school competition, all ages, and we came up with the name Seoltar na Gcaillimhe, which is Irish for Galway Sailor, which was a nice title. Then we decided we had to sit down as, and we had discussed what we're going to put, what are we going to put on the boat, what drawings, what artwork, and what are we going to put into the boat. So you can see there on the right-hand side, the sail. One of my favorite poems, and I happened to be doing it at the time, was The Rime of the Ancient Mariner, which is a wonderful poem, and it kind of ties in perfectly with this whole program. So you can see there, one of the drawings here is of an albatross. Then we have an Irish harp with some cultural references all over the boat. We have some of our favorite Irish sayings. And then we have different pictures of local sports like Irish hurling, Irish football. So we had a great fun actually brainstorming, looking at what's important to the children, like from an Irish perspective, what we might put onto the boat and into the boat that would represent our school, our county, and our country. So, and we also have in there, we had a very famous Irish poet here called the Galway Hooker, and that's also painted onto the main boat there. So we put on a little Irish message there, good luck, and the ancient languages. So we look back at our culture, it gives us a great chance to kind of refocus on our own culture, you know, what we might want to represent ourselves on that boat. They also put in their favorite Irish animals and fish species. They did drawings of them. I had a wonderful art class. Children were super, as you can see there from the art, really went well. And then I did the John Keats lines from that famous poem. And we looked at the Irish flag. We tried to do as much as possible to represent our country. And then inside, we had great fun trying to plan what to put inside the boat. So we looked at, we did some drawings. We did some little poetry based on our school and our county. We did some artwork. And then we put in lots and lots of treats, lots of sweets and things. So we were hoping maybe a family or a child might find the boat, and whoever found the boat would be in for a real fun time. So, and also a few little Irish toys and emblems, things that represent our school and our country. So we had really good fun doing that. So that took quite a while to do, as you can see. And it was a labor of love, really. Everybody took their time and they put a lot of effort into making sure everything looked perfect. Thanks, Kieran, for that slide, yeah. And then we had an online meeting with Kieran, and we met some other schools, and we kind of shared our experiences, which was great. So we were all kind of in the same boat. Some we had already sent our boat off, and other schools were just starting. So we were able to kind of share some of our ideas of what we were doing with the boat and what we were putting into the boat. Then we had, a school from Canary Islands and a school from Portugal in that meeting. Then Porrick from the Explorers Education Program, which helped us a lot with the Marine Institute, they visited the school to give a presentation to arrange experiments and discuss the mini boat. So we did a lot of learning based around the boat. It was the perfect kind of STEM linkage program. So we had ICT in there, we had literacy in there, we had science in there. And then of course we linked it in with other non-STEM subjects like geography and literacy. Then Kusha from the Camden Trust provided a number of Explorers Ocean literacy resources and art materials as activities for learning about the ocean. So it was a real team effort of ourselves and the Marine Institute and the Explorers programs. We all worked really together. So we combined the enthusiasm of the children with the expertise of the Camden Trust and the Marine Institute, which is super. Thanks, Kieran.
Great. Thanks for that, Peter. I'll go on. Yeah, so after that, then Peter and the pupils delivered the boat to the Celtic Explorer. So these pictures were taken as the vessel was being mobilized for the Aimshire cruise. And this was on the 31st of May, 2021. So it was just before we went out on our cruise. You can see we got some good weather for that, which was good. Just to say a little bit, I suppose, about the Aimshire cruise, which is the Atlantic in situ scientific infrastructure replacement. Aimshire means weather in Irish, so it's a good acronym, a suitable acronym for our cruise. And it went out from the 31st of May to the 7th of June last year on the RV Celtic Explorer. So the main aims of the cruise were to recover and to redeploy a number of key marine research infrastructures, including the M6 Weatherboy, which is where the Galway Sailor mini boat was launched, the Rockall deep water mooring, which is a mooring with a number of CTDs attached, which goes down to about 3,000 meters below the sea surface, and the EBS-1 and EBS-2 shelf landers. So we also deployed three Argo floats, a Maloa drifter, and the Galway Sailor mini boat. And this is a picture here of the crew then just taken just after we arrived back. Just some of, a few photos of the activity then that took place on board. So on the left here, you can see the mini boat in the dry lab before it was deployed. So it had a little bit of work to do just to seal the hatch and to apply a layer of epoxy resin to protect the great paintings and the pictures that that the pupils of Kilglass had done. In the middle here, you can see our chief scientist, Conal O'Malley, and another marine research infrastructures team member, Christine Loughlin, who was very heavily involved in the deployment. And then below that, you can see that where the boat, the mini boat, is being deployed by the crew of the Celtic Explorer off the side of the vessel. So there's they use two little straps and slings to lower the boat down over the edge. And then finally on the right, you can see the mini boat with the M6 buoy in the background. So it's a little bit misleading. It looks that the M6 buoy is quite small. It's in reality, it's huge in comparison to the mini boat, but it was nice to get them both in the same shot. And as you can see, we were very lucky with the weather, and it was very clear and calm when the mini boat was launched. So this is the position here in the top photo on the right of where the mini boat was launched beside the new M6 buoy, and it was deployed on the 2nd of June of last year at around 9 o'clock at the coordinates there beside the newly deployed M6 data buoy. So just a bit about the M6 buoy then. It's a very important piece of infrastructure for the Marine Institute. It's the most westerly buoy of the Irish Marine Data Buoy Observation Network. And data from the network is used by Met Éireann for the forecasting systems, and the UK Met Office then for climatological purposes. And it's a key, as I said, it's a key piece of infrastructure, and it's recognised by EU MetNet as a significant piece of infrastructure providing data to the European meteorological system. Just a little bit about the journey. So the boats, the initial journey of the boat. The GPS transmission stopped on the 14th of June after 12 days at sea, and the last recorded position then was just southeast of the Faroe Islands, which is highlighted in the picture here. So at the time, it was the most northerly recorded mini boat of all the mini boats. When it stopped, there was a lot of people were following. I know Peter and the children and a lot of their friends, and also us in the Marine Institute, we were following it. So we didn't know what would happen then or where it would show up. But luckily then the boat was discovered then on the 18th of July. So we got some good news by Lars Bjornsson and his family. And this is on Bunez Beach above the Arctic Circle in Lofoten Island in Norway. So it made it quite a long way up there, a long way, quite far north. And it was over 11,100 kilometers from its last GPS reported location. So luckily, Peter from Lars got in touch with Peter and Kilglass. And he said that, my three girls were very excited to open the hatch and see the content. Unfortunately, all the drawings and letters were wet, but we were still able to read some of it. And he said, thanks for the candy and the other stuff that was contained in the hatch. So we're glad that it was discovered and somebody was able to find it and to get to see the work that the children had done on it and the bits that they put in the hatch. Just a little bit here on the model journey. So estimated journey after the mini boat stopped its transmission. So colleagues of ours in the Marine Institute and the ocean modeling team provided a map here showing the estimated journey between its last location and where it was discovered in Norway. And knowing the last coordinates and the location where the boat was found, the team were able to produce this map showing the boat's likely movement based on the currents and wind direction at the time. And they also had the dates as well, which was useful. Just a little bit then, about the Blue Schools, the EU Blue Schools initiative. So Kilglass is one of the first schools in Ireland to become a European Blue School in May, so just a couple of months ago. The Blue School, it's an EU initiative for schools that are involved in marine research and marine science. So it's a very, very very high honour for the school to be awarded this, and well done to them for that. So you can see a picture of Peter here and the director of the Marine Institute, Dr. Paul Connolly, receiving the certificate, handing over to Peter. Just a couple of quotes here then from Peter on the program. So working in the project provided us with an excellent opportunity to involve all of the school in a marine themed project. everyone took ownership of the project, from painting and naming the boat to the handover at the RV Celtic Explorer for its launch at sea, and also tracking it while at sea. And good to see our director as well, Paul Connolly, who is also very interested in this project. He said, to become a European Blue School, students are encouraged to become responsible and engaged ocean literate citizens. The Shoulter na Gáilíomar, the Galway Miniboat Unmanned Miniboat Project, demonstrated that the children from Kilglass recognise the importance of our ocean in our lives. So our next steps, we're hoping to make a connection between a school in Norway who are potentially interested in redeploying the vessel and Kilglass National School. We've some initial discussions to connect with other marine or other marine institutes and research centres in Norway to hopefully help out the school with their deployment of the vessel whenever this happens, and then hopefully the possible redeployment of the Galway Sailor in the near future. I've also put a few in good media links here of stories that were released about the miniboat. Particularly, there's a nice video there which summarizes the whole process up until the handover of the boat at the Celtic Explorer, and also some story about the discovery of the boat and then the award of the Blue Awards. So just want to finish off, but thanks everyone for your time, but thanks to everyone who was involved. It was a huge team effort. So thanks to Peter and Kilglass and the pupils from last year. Thanks a lot to Cassie as well, who was very instrumental in getting the mini boat launched. The Marine Institute Research Infrastructures team, so Felicity, who assembled the boat, Connell, who was the chief scientist on the cruise, and Alan, who's a section manager, to Sheila and Rachel and the Marine Institute Communications team, the crew from the Celtic Explorer who deployed the vessel, Pórach from Explorers Education Programme, and Kushla from Camden Trust, and then for all the iFADO projects for the interesting interaction that we had and the connection with the schools along the way. So thanks very much.
I'd just like to thank yourself and everybody you've mentioned on behalf of the school for giving us the boat to begin with, and then for all your help and expertise along the way. Thanks very much. And just one thing to add is it takes on life of its own, and it actually goes outside the school. It becomes a community event. I think the first person who rang me to say the GPS had broken down was my brother. He was at home. So everybody got interested. It's a real great way of bringing STEM into the community, and a real kind of live and a happy event for everybody. So it's a real community event in the end for us. And hopefully someday we'll get it relaunched and we can follow it again. So thanks again, everybody, for all your support and all your funding and all your expertise. Thank you.
Thanks, Peter.
Okay. So thank you so much, Kieran and Peter. That's is very exciting. I mean, I can only imagine the kids in the beach receiving a mini boat with some treats inside. That must be something very, very nice, very interesting. Well, so we will continue with our session. Now I ask Carlos Barreira from Plocan. Please, Carlos, introduce yourself and then tell your story.
Thank you, Jose Luis. Hello, everybody. Always a pleasure to join, and thanks for having Plocan involved in this today's Networking Friday session, in particular, the particular one, really wonderful approach. So it's always a pleasure to join these Networking Fridays. So congrats for the team at Air Center. And of course, thanks to the iFADO coordination for the initiative. iFADO, a project where Plocan is involved as a World Package 5 leader. So World Package 5 is related to in situ and novel technologies for ocean observing. And in some way, so it has to be understood that the promotion of the where we are today here, so presenting the activities related to miniboats in the framework of iFADO, because in some way we suggested as a leaders of this work package, so to connect ocean technology for ocean observing with ocean literacy. So then it becomes an idea, and as far as I remember, in one of the initial meetings, GAs we had in the framework of the project, so we suggested that, and step by step, slowly but continuously, so things has become quite improving, and so it's part of the result today where we are, in particular with this activity. So, but the But just let me context a little bit the contribution of Plocan to this wonderful program of ocean literacy and in some way ocean observing. We started in 2012 approximately, and today, from my understanding, from our understanding here in Plocan, it's quite an important milestone. So because we started, as I said before, in 2012, and I want to thank once again today to Rick Baldwin and James Manning at NOAA for the opportunity to start this cooperation at that time. So because we started basically launching mini boats that were built up in US by secondary schools. So it was Glenna in 2014. So it was our first approach. So in terms of deployments from the Canary Islands in the educational passages program. So and then from this launching, so we decide, because of course the shipping, to ship a mini boat from US to Canary Islands is not a quick and easy task. So then we decide why not to start to build up so the mini boats here in the Canary Islands. And then we started the series of Canarias, so from Canarias 1 to Canarias 4. And also with some cooperation, some specific cooperation with other teams, other schools in Europe, it was the case of Boot. So then in the next slides, I will just very briefly, I will show you as an overview, our experience in this specific context between 2014 and 2018. So it was, this is, was the our first launching, so from Gran Canaria. And fortunately, we reached Brazil. So we crossed the Atlantic, our first deployment. So we succeed. So everything was really, really amazing and exciting. So the schools in Gran Canaria also get in touch with real school for sure, and other secondary schools in the area of Maine in US. So it was really, really a fantastic starting with this program, educational program. And yeah, and this is just to give you an idea, well, a picture, a better approach where the mini boat reached in the area of Brazil. And as I said before, we started more seriously the cooperation, just basically developing our own mini boats. So in Gran Canaria, in order to become more efficient and to provide more context in this important program. So and then it was Canarias 1, so in 2015, and a specific cooperation with the students from French Lyceum of Gran Canaria, and getting the most from a specific program in regards Fragata Lermion. It touched Gran Canaria, and then in collaboration with the French Lyceum. So we organized this launching, the preparation of the mini boat, and then the launching. That unfortunately, it was not really, really successful that the previous one. You can see here the path. So the mini boat was deployed from, something came up here. Someone just share screen, right?
Oh, you can reshare.
Yeah, someone.
Yeah, you can reshare your screen.
Yeah, sure. Just a second.
Sorry about that, yeah.
Just a second, yeah. Now it's fine, once again.
Yes, thank you.
No, but I'm not able to move my presentation right now for some reason. I'm going to try once again.
Yeah. Maybe if we close and open it over again. Yeah.
No.
Are you clicking the right screen? Maybe if you close, I mean, the PowerPoint and then open the PowerPoint again.
Okay, let me try once again. Now it's fine.
Yeah, cool.
Okay, so then it was deployed from Lermion, South Gran Canaria, and you can see here on the map the path described by the mini boat up to Senegal coast, more or less, where a fisherman decide that it would be better to pick it up and put it as an ornamental object in its home. So, and here it's the final story of Canarias One. So we were able to find the place. We contact some locals, local friends there, and finally we were basically get able to get this picture, this nice picture. But unfortunately, it was the end of the journey for Canarias One. So then we came back some months later with Canarias Two. Here you can see it was already a Canarian boat as well, in collaboration with ES Garoe at the island of El Hierro, so southwest of Canary Islands archipelago. And here you can see some highlights of the deployment and the dates and the travel. It was quite complex and challenging and amazing journey from Canarias to from Gran Canaria up to Riviera Maya in Mexico, in the area of Tulum. And we also install a new GPS generation at that time. And well, basically it was the summary and the end of the Canarias Two. It was a landfill in the Tulum area, and unfortunately it was not possible to pick it up and put it back in the water, unfortunately. So the Canarias Three, you can see here the same approach. It was also a cooperation with ES Garoe at the island of El Hierro, and in that case it disappeared in waters of North Puerto Rico Island in the Caribbean, and again, it was not possible to recover for a relaunching or refurbishment and things like that. So here, just some highlights of the collaboration with ES Garoe and also some agencies in the island of El Hierro in terms of boat support for launching and the first hours survey in order that make sure that everything was working properly. Boot, it was a specific cooperation with a Belgium school at San Francisco's Evergame in 2017. And here you can see also the same approach in terms of the map, the launching area, South Gran Canaria, with the school involved here. We install also a solar panel, a water temperature sensor, and our own satellite telemetry. Unfortunately, it was picked up just a few days, 1 week later of the deployment, by a Morocco military boat. And then from the GPS, we get some signal once inland. We tried to recover and put it back into the water, but unfortunately it was not possible due to difficulties on the conversations with the Moroccan military staff. And we decide to not go further on this. And unfortunately, it was a very, very short journey for Boot. Just some highlights of the cooperation here in regards to Boot with a local school in Gran Canaria, in the south of Gran Canaria, for the launching, and also the final settings of preparation. And from this bad experience of Boot, we decide to, with the same school in Gran Canaria, so ES Amurga, in San Fernando de Maspalomas, we decide to build our own mini boat. So in that case, Canarias 4, and it was launched just for trials in June 2017. And with the solar panel as water temperature and a specific own satellite telemetry, but due to a satellite telemetry failure in this trial, we had to test it again and put it back in the lab for some tuning. And finally, here you can see the schematics of the technology, the additional technology we put in order to make sure that everything was working fine in terms of the measurements, the signal process, and also the battery capacity, et cetera, just to give you a flavor on that. And also the schematic of the where these electronics were placed in the mini boat, just to give you an idea on how it was this work. And here, basically, we create a new user manual for in order to to provide a more accurate information to the schools in the area. It was also uploaded on the Procan website. So in order to share this experience and this knowledge with the rest of the schools interested to join this this program. And finally, so the Canarias 4 was deployed in May 2018 in the area in the island of El Hierro, again in cooperation with ES Garoe. And you can see here the map with the track of the of the of the miniboat. And again, so the currents, so we finally understood that there is a strong current going in parallel to the Northwest African inland. And finally, the miniboat, it was picked up again from in the area of Guinea coast, and it was bring it back to South Dakar. So it was a quite coincidence. And we discovered that the, it was it ended in the same house of the previous Canarias 2. So here you can see the pictures we were able to also to get from local contacts in Senegal. And here is the, basically the end of the journey for Canarias 4. And some years later, in 2022, with already within the framework of iFADO, we started once again with the deployments for the reasons I mentioned in the, at the very beginning of the of my presentation today. And here it was the first attempt, so iFADO 1. And you can see here that unfortunately the journey was not really, really long way. Basically, because we lose connection from the GPS and maybe still sailing, but of course we don't know where it is, if it's the case. So in other words, so it was not recovered for to basically have the opportunity to check where it was located, the potential failure. You can see here the students in El Hierro Island that joined the deployment and the preparation. A specific preparation here and a specific collaboration with Civitas in Gran Canaria that I want to thank very, very much once again today for their involvement and contribution in this program, and specifically with the iFADO 1 miniboat. And finally, this is where we are right now. So iFADO 2, it was deployed recently from La Palma, from Tafacorte Harbor. So again, and today I want to thank the collaboration with ES Eusebio Barreto, the students and the coordinator there for the effort to make it possible in a record time. So thank you very much. And of course, from the support of the Ayuntamiento of Tazacorte, Los Llanos, for all the contributions and all the support for this launching. And well, that's pretty much the situation right now. So from yesterday, so it's basically iFADO 2. It's almost in the middle of the Atlantic. So trying to reach the medium, the medium part of the track, and it's performing quite well. And hopefully, we wish a very, very successful and long way. So to the Caribbean, or who knows, maybe to get the Florida current and sail north through the to the Gulf Strait. So, and that's pretty much what I have for you today. So just a small video here in at La Restinga, South El Hierro. As far as I remember, I think this is Canarias 3. So just to give you an idea and a flavor about the landscape of the Canary Islands for those not familiar. And yeah, that's all what I have. So thank you very much. And if there is any question, happy to answer today, if there is time, or later on, so through iFADO contacts or myself, so feel free to reach out. Thank you very much once again.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much, Carlos. I have somebody here on my side, it's Frank Miller-Carga, that will ask you some questions later.
Hey, good to see you.
He's very excited once again. Here. Yes. Yeah, so, but I mean, he will ask his question in the Q&A part.
Exactly. Okay? Thank you.
And then we will continue with, I mean, Okay, good. Teresa is ready already. Good to know. So, Teresa, can you introduce yourself? Paulo and Teresa, can you introduce yourself and just tell your story together with Mohammed Adani?
I lost the button for opening the micro, and now I will share the screen again. Okay, so my name is Paulo. I'm at the office in IPMA, and I will briefly give my view of this adventure of the Tuga de Costa Azul. So I've picked up as a first slide the site from web educational passage where you have the fleet from the ISO. So thanks very much, Cassie, for setting up this page of the iFADO fleet. So our journey started back in January 2020 when we finally got the miniboat from our colleagues from Plocan. So it was an offer from Plocan. Thank you very much, Carlos, for that and for all the trouble that to be able to get the miniboat into Portugal was not that easy. The first idea I had, because I have very strong connections with this school in Sesimbra, was to present the miniboat to the kids, and I had this first experience to challenge the kids to guess where the miniboat was going with the wind. So it was already an exciting experience to see that the kids were loving to play with how quick the kids bond with the object and how powerful this is as an educational tool. Then I went based on that strong impression that this miniboats work like magnets to call the attention of the kids. I went to this this Escola Básica de Castel and I presented the boat to the kids and also take advantage of that to make a presentation on how we should care about the ocean and what the scientists are doing to tackle this ocean health problem and how it connects with the actual legislation of the Marine Strategy Framework Directive. So it was a series of talks that I've made there, and then one group that you will hear about it, that the teacher is online, and I want to speed up so to give the floor to her and to the Moroccan kids that also have now the boat. So this is one of the activities that also was very pleasant, is because the schools, they have their own journal, and so it was also a very good experience to have news being posted in the school's journal. It was very, very pleasing. And so this is Kieran already spoke about this. It was another fantastic experience, was to be able to connect the various schools and be able to do this event. It was absolutely fantastic. The interaction between this group of kids that painted the mini boat was also a very pleasant journey in an ancient boat, a fishing boat that we were able, or especially because the teacher was very keen to be able to connect with this the owner of this because it was too close to go to it was too risky to do that and on the left side you see the bottle, so to even make it more clear the idea that these boats can be regarded as a 21st century message in a bottle. They actually wrote the messages and what they think that will be the best objects to put inside the mini boats. Well, the miniboat was launched from a research vessel that was carrying out fisheries. It was a fisheries survey that we had in March this year, and the idea was to launch the miniboats also nearby the Sagres Cape, that is the cape that we all Portuguese recognize as an historical place for these nautical adventures, ancients back in 15th century. And so this is a snapshot of all the excitement of, I was here in the office, and the colleagues were, we were designing and using WhatsApp to decide the actual place to release. Meanwhile, while the miniboat was released, and then it started the amusement around seeing the trajectory of the miniboat. And I took the opportunity to get back to the sailing school and showing to the kids how the boat was sailing, and call them to the attention of the intensity of the winds, the pattern of the winds, and so forth. So, so you can see that you have here a little bit of a video where you can see that I was using the site, the web page of Educational Passages, and because the actual trajectories of this miniboat and the Kraken that was already at sea and it was sailing right. And almost a straight line to Brazil. It was very easy to talk with the kids and call them their attention for the diversity of the wind patterns and how they behave, these mini boats that go with the wind. And especially to talk about the trade winds and the regions where the winds are much more variable, and the parts of the planet where the winds are much more stable. And here you have one of the most amusing parts from the computer side of this. It was to play with the trajectories and try to guess where the miniboat was will be. Some 2 or 3 days after we got the messages. So what you see in the colors is the intensity of wind. The white lines are the direction of the wind. The blue line is the actual trajectory of the wind, and the green and red, two possible predictions of the wind taking more time to learn or less time to learn. And then you will see that In mid-April, the miniboat was tempted to go to Morocco, and it ended there. One thing about these videos was very pleased to have the kids asking why it did not follow the blue or the green line, it's so easy, because this is a fantastic tool, because it's very, very easy to get questions from the kids, and then you start talking about what drives the atmosphere, what drives the ocean, it's a fantastic tool. I will not spend too much time, because I know that Mohammed has something to tell about this, and I will close my microphone to leave the floor for Mohammed and Teresa Oliveira, that was the teacher, so that she can share also her experience, and thank you.
Thank you, Paulo. Hello, everybody. Thank you for your invitation for this event. The topic of my presentation is about the miniboat Touga between the Moroccan Atlantic coast and the subsequent activities with the students who received the miniboat from the town of Safi. First of all, thanks to the coordination of the Portuguese team and collaborators who facilitated the task for offering the exact location of the miniboat Touga in the Atlantic coast, north of Safi, near the village Douza. Unfortunately, this event made it difficult for me to travel from Algeria in direction to the Douza village near the Safi, miles north of Safi. I have some illustrations. Some photos from the location of Beachy, the woods. With the GPS localization map, it was able to approach.
Sorry, yeah. Mohamed, we cannot see your presentation. We are not seeing your presentation.
And now, photos from the location.
Still not, see, maybe no? You should stop sharing for a while and then try again. No, already clicking in the presentation now. Oh, perfect. Yes.
Some photos from the location near the Safi city. With the GPS localization map, it was able to approach the localization of the house that hosts the miniboats. And thanks to a local resident who helped me to locate the house of fishermen who found the Touga miniboats on the evening of April 7th. According to him, the miniboat localization in the water is easy with naked eye at the time, and the beaching was easy to in the shoreline of Sandy Beach. His house is situated not far from the coastline. It is transported manually. I show him some photos with other activities with miniboat Sisimbra carried out in a school in the Al Jadida city last year. He was glad and happy with the story of miniboat's program. The condition of miniboat is perfect with sail and GPS associated with the battery. The inside of boat miniboat is completely dry without leakage. After a few days later, I returned to the Safi city to meet with the professor, Masoud Lahouri, teacher of life and earth sciences, with his students, to give him an overview about the project and the activities related to the miniboats. The choice of school in Safi city comes because, on the one hand, the beaching boat miniboat is in an area not far from Safi city, and the other hand, I am from Safi and I have a friend who is a teacher, I think, which will facilitate it, the coordination between us. Finally, I will now turn over to my friend, Professor Masoud, and his student to speaking about the future activities related to the miniboat Touga. I have to pass the word from the Professor Lahouri and Miriam, student of professor. Thank you all for your attention. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I'm very happy to stay here in this meeting. Thank you for this invitation, for this event. We are very happy to be here. I got to be here.
Thank you for this invitation. We are with small boat here. We did with our work to look at the boat from the outside and touch open boats with our teacher. We were surprised and very happy to receive the gift offered by the students of the Chuka School from Portugal after a long crossing in the Atlantic Ocean. As it is already the end of the school year, it is scheduled next September. A presentation by our teacher and the objective of this program. The activities we will carry out with the mini boat in order to relaunch it again. We will organize a new meeting online with the students of Chuka to show the gifts offered, and we try to translate the messages received. We are very happy to integrate this program and all the meeting with other translating schools. Thank you very much. See you soon as possible.
So marine pollution is a combination of chemical and trash, most of which comes from land sources and is washed or blown into the ocean. This pollution is a significant damage of the environment to the health of all organisms and the economic circle worldwide. So what is the pollution in the sea? Common man-made pollutants that reach the ocean include all industrial chemical and sewage. Many ocean pollutants are released into the environment far upstream from the cast line. So the most ocean pollution begins on land, much of these runoff flows on the sea, carrying with agriculture fertilizer 80% of pollution to the marine. Environment comes from the land. One of the biggest sources is called non-potassium pollution, which occurs as a result of runoff. So how much pollution in the sea is? Estimate 8 million tons of plastic enters our oceans every year. There are 25 trillion pieces of plastic waste are estimated to be in our ocean. 269,000 tons flood, 4 billion microfibers. 70% of our ocean, 70% of our debris skins into the ocean's ecosystem. 50% floods and 50% sands are our beaches. As excess debris in the ocean slowly degrades over many years, it uses oxygen to do so, resulting in less O2 in the ocean. Low levels of oxygen in the ocean lead to the death of ocean animals such as penguins, dolphins, whales, and sharks. Excess nitrogen and phosphorus in seawater also cause oxygen depletion. Main of causes of water pollution. So for example, global warming, deforestation, industry, agricultural, and livestock farming, rubbish and fossil water dumping, maritime traffic, and food spillages. Here are 7 ways you can make a difference starting today. Reduce your use of single-use plastics, support the listen to club plastic reduction on waste, recycle properly, participate in or organize a beach or river cleanup, avoid products containing microbeads, and spread the word. Thank you very much for listening to this. I'm very happy. If you have a question, I'm here. Please don't be shy.
Oh, thank you so much for this very important messages and for the presentation. We're very happy to have you here. I must say that Morocco is a full member of their center. So it's very, very nice to have people from Morocco in this meeting for the very first time. Fantastic. Thank you so much. Very excited.
You're welcome. I'm very happy to stay here in this event. I learned so much. And thank you for this invitation. I'm very glad, very, very, very much.
Yeah. And thank you for your fantastic words. You're welcome. Kids. Yeah. So before passing to Teresa Oliveira, Paulo Oliveira has his hand raised. You want to say something, yeah, Paolo?
Yeah, just I'm very curious what they decided to do with the small objects that we put inside the miniboat. I'm just curious to know, and if they managed to translate the messages, because this blue the blue papers that you have sent, they were inside the boat. So I would just get very curious to know what their plans for that.
Can you repeat, please? I
will
listen so much.
Yeah.
No, pardon. Point of view. Myriam, tu peux montrer les cadeaux qui sont à l'intérieur du bateau. Il y a des objets qui sont à l'intérieur du bateau. Donc, vous pouvez le montrer. Vous pouvez montrer le bateau et l'intérieur, donc les articles et les objets qui sont à l'intérieur. S'il vous plaît. Thank you.
Plus important que les objets, c'est les plans qu'ils ont. Comment est-ce qu'ils vont distribuer par là?
Exactement. c'est Paul. We have a problem, but I have big work for translate the words Portuguese for him.
Present us the miniboat, and with the presentation about the ocean's health. Too many classes here in the school. And me and these 20 little guys, we embraced the project. So first thing, to give a name to the boat. So Leonor proposed the Tuga name, which is a little name for Portuguese. For our nationality, and then we gave this big name, iFADO, Tuga from the Costa Azul, Blue Coast, and this is his name. And then we began these conversations with Paulo about what we are going to do now with the boat before he sending anywhere. And then we painted it with the symbols of Zimbra, and that those big eyes that are watching, it's the fishermen's, I think they are watching the sea. And the big day of testing the boat was also a very nice day, very, very, very interesting. We bet the destiny of the boat, and now here we are. And then when the boat went to Morocco, Paulo sent us the Paulo Judam, the
yeah, we were following we were following the
line
the,
of the
yeah we were following of the very enthusiastic
and I sent it to the kids.
This moment of the arrival of the boats to the beach is very enthusiastic. I felt like watching the arrivals of the men at the moon. It was just very, very exciting. So it's very pleasant. Okay, so
it was thank very, you. Very nice.
Thank you very much. I guess we don't have time to ask.
I just want to say something, Paul.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But the kids have to go because this is lunchtime, yeah. And these moms,
yeah,
texting.
It was,
so I'm
it
sorry.
Was,
okay, say goodbye. Yeah.
In any case, it was very good to have. Bye bye.
So,
thank you very much.
So
thank
I am
you.
Here.
So, Teresa.
They are going.
Yeah, Teresa. Just can you introduce
thank you,
them? God. Yeah, can you introduce them by name? Yes, please. Yeah.
I'm sorry. I will. Sorry. It's Leonor.
Hello, Leonor. Marta.
Martin.
Martin.
Marta, Martin. E Francisco.
Hello, Francisco. Hi, thank
Francisco.
You so much. Yes. Obrigado. Yeah.
They were very nice because they were the only response today. Very, very, very good.
Okay. Thank you very much. Bye, bye, bye. So we'll continue with our journey now with Anaïs Turpo. I mean, with Coringa boat experience. Anaïs, can you introduce yourself?
Yes, then, of course.
And then do you tell your story?
Hello to everyone. I will just share my screen. Just a second. Okay. Can you see it?
Yes, we can. Yes.
Okay, perfect. So nice to meet you. It's a pleasure to be with you for this session. I'm Anaïs Turpo from Polmer Bretagne Atlantique, a cluster, French cluster dedicated to maritime innovation. So in the iFADO project, we are in charge of the capitalization work package. So I will tell you about our miniboat experience in France. And as you may have understood from the maps that have been presented, we are the last country to launch our miniboat in the framework of the project. So the story will be a little shorter than my colleagues, but still, I will tell you. I'm very sorry that the college represented are not present today, but the classes are over in France and the teachers are busy supervising the exams until tonight, so they cannot be with us, and we are very sorry about that. First of all, just to let you know that we are located in Brest, in Brittany, halfway between the English Channel and the Bay of Biscay, which allows for many possible scenarios regarding to the drift of the miniboat. So we are a bit excited regarding the launch of the miniboat. So concerning the school, we chose to work with the Saint-Vincent College in Brest for several reasons. The first one was the geographical proximity, which have facilitated the exchanges with the teachers and the students. And the second reason was that many of our colleagues had studied there themselves a few years or a lot of years ago. So it was nice to be back in the college. And last but not least, the third reason was the enthusiasm of the teaching staff when the project was proposed to them. It was very pleasant because the whole teaching team took part in the experience and proposed an adapted program by putting the miniboat as a common thread in the learning process for the students. So it was really interesting. For example, in French, they were doing communication activities. In mathematics, they build compass rows in geometry. In history, they were learning oceanography and so on. So it was really nice for them to learn everything around the miniboat experience. So the students that were concerned by the miniboat activities were in fifth grade, and it so 90 students were involved in the project. So here you can see some pictures of the constructions. So the students were very interested and motivated to participate. As you can see, they were learning about the currents. They organized a contest for drawing the sail. So you can see it was painted so nicely. And here you can see the result. So here is the Corrigan miniboat. So Corrigan is a kind of leprechaun here in Brittany. And you can see a lot of symbols on the sail. So the stoat, which is a regional emblem, is carrying a bagpipe with the regional flag from Brittany on it. And the Corrigan is a pirate, just for the link with the ocean. So here is the result. We decided a month ago to organize a preliminary launch. So it was organized during the World Ocean Day, which was really symbolic, with the students, some students ambassadors, the local press, and some Navy representative, as the French Navy will launch the mini boat in few weeks. So you can see some pictures. So there were 8 students during the preliminary launch. And if it works, I have a small video to share.
I don't know if the video has sound, but I don't hear.
I hope it worked.
Yes, you could see the video. Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Perfect. So as you have seen, the students were really happy to launch it. So it was really, really nice. So what's next? The next step is to test the last sensors with educational passages. It will be done next week with Cassie. After that, we will deal with the French Navy, who will deploy the miniboat during a mission abroad during the summer. So hopefully at the end of July or early August. And then, as you did, we will track the miniboat online, do the follow-up, and hopefully it will be recovered and relaunch. So the fingers crossed. And we will keep you updated, of course. That's it for France.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. So we will need a new networking Friday later.
Of course.
Next year, to know where it went. And now it's, I mean, the Case Kraken mini boat experience.
Hello all. Yes, my name's Sue Hartman. Hi, yes, I'm standing in for Cale, who's away today. And unfortunately, the school couldn't join us. Magda, most of the sixth form have left school now, and the rest of them is nearing holidays. But anyway, so from the, we're both researchers, Cale and I, at the NOC in Southampton in the UK. And yeah, so we've got the story to share of the Kes Kraken. So our journey kind of started a year ago with Cale going in to talk at the science festival at the school. And he gave a talk there, and then a demonstration of the mini boats at the end. And then a few people signed up and showed enthusiasm, which was great. I mean, he had quite a lot of children to talk to and a range of ages. And Kes is for the name of the school. So it's King Edward VI. It's known locally as Kes. Our link with the school with Magda. Magda's the physics teacher there and a science coordinator for the junior years. And so from September onwards last year, we kind of went into the school. Various people gave talks over a number of weeks on ocean currents, microplastics, autonomous robotic systems. There's a picture here of Alice giving a talk on the microplastics, which the kids found especially inspiring. And then the students started to build their mini boat. And so the ours were kind of covered with lots of different handprints. I think the painting at the end of the actual boat was quite rushed, but the sail, absolutely lovely. You can see the kraken there, you can see the eye and the whole sea monster. So it was a few 12, 13 year old second year students, but they had a lot of sixth form, you know, helpers in there as well. And they actually built the whole boat themselves and put, you know, the sensors and everything in there, the solar panels on and so on. So they had the whole project, to do, and then put things into the watertight cargo. This is this is now on the right, the picture is the Kraken at NOC, and we've now added our iFADO logo. This was one of the first to have the extra scientific sensors. So I was quite excited about this project and it going into the ocean. And then this picture here shows the Kraken with some sort of last minute sealing and a lot of work to make the boat a bit more seaworthy once it arrived, including turning the sail around once it arrived at NOC. And Nick Rundell was really helpful there, and also in lifting the boat onto the Discovery. So I'd initially hoped that we'd be able to launch the mini boat at the PAP site, which is where I work in the Northeast Atlantic, but that wouldn't have been till May. So that was a bit late for the school. And so luckily Discovery was going out in February and the guys on board chatted with the school. Unfortunately, due to COVID restrictions, they couldn't go on the ship to meet the scientists, but they had Zoom link chats. And then the maiden voyage of the Kraken was in February on the in the tropics. So this is our large project called the Rapid, and the Rapid Array is a series of moorings that go right across the Atlantic, and we've also got auto samplers there, and they take measurements over 18-month period, so they're out for a long time, the moorings. And they go and service these cruisers and make biogeochemical measurements and physics measurements around looking at the flow of water. So it was during the Rapid expedition that the boat was launched, and you can see it here. This is a still from the video that I'll try and show at the end. So the boat was launched on in February, and there you go. There's a still from the video. You can only just see the boat as soon as it's launched. It's really tiny in the ocean, but they did have, you know, it's the tropics. It was probably a better place than PAP to be launching a small boat like that. And then the kids could follow on with wind and currents. And I think the primary current here is the equatorial current heading here towards South America. And in fact, it got over in kind of record time, 45 days at sea before it landed in Brazil, traveling some 4,000 kilometers. And I think you might hear more later about how it was recovered, but it looks in rather good nick. There's a nice picture here of the sail, and also another picture of in launch, but there's many people to thank, and they're listed here, but also on the educational passage, passages site, but Cassie especially, and Kale and others from NOC that gave the talks. Even people from CFAS were involved, and we actually had a few projects as well as iFADO was the primary sponsor for the mini boat, but we also had Diapod and Go-Kart sponsoring the project, and obviously like to thank the thank everyone involved in this. And I will try and show the video here. So there we go. I hope you can see that. It's been, I'll kind of jump here to where it's up in the sky. So the crane went right across the deck of the ship, launched over here on the port side. Into relatively calm waters. It looked like it was going towards the ship. So they're running across, hoping they'll see it come out the other, there you go. There's the Kes Kraken setting off on its journey. So thank you very much.
Oh, thank you so much, Sue. This is brilliant. Yeah, very nice video. So now we will hear from Gabrielle, who helped find, yeah, so Gabriel, okay, good. Gabriel, can you introduce yourself and then say something about how you recovered the miniboat?
Okay, thank you, Moutinho, for the invite. Hello, everyone. I'm Gabriel from Brazil. I'm a prorector of the State University of Amapá in the north of the Brazil, in middle of the Amazon rainforest. And I tell to us about our history. Unfortunately, the Brazilian school team was unable to connect to us, but they chose the name of the presentation and chose the new name of the Kraken. Nice to meet you, Sue, and thank you to send Kraken to us across the ocean. it's a good history to tell to our time. So the first contact about the mini boat was in April, and the Iceland crew called to us, and the university called to the ICM Bio Institute, a national institute about that work with the biodiversity in our country. So I special thanks to the Chico Mendes Institute about their skill and the help and the everyone to the take to us the miniboat Kraken. So for the localization, for all, we stay here in the South America, more precisely in the mouth of the Amazon River. And here is the capital of the state, and the miniboat come to here more or less, next to the Bailik Archipelago and Sucuriju community. So the position, more precisely, is here between the Maracay station, the biodiversity and preservation station, to Iceland with the most number of the jaguar in the world. And I have a good video to share to you. And the mini boats arrive here, and here have a the next or closest community to the part. It's an hospitality part. It's not not have community near to here, just rainforest and preserved area, because have some jaguar and some species of birds just only have here. So this help of the crew of the SMBU, we can rescue the boat in this part with the help with the maps, because don't have connected to GPS or internet in this part. It's so difficult to travel and to communicate. So I have two videos to show the rescue. The first videos is here, the rescue in the coast of Amapá. It's a different ocean. It's not the same ocean, the same Atlantic Ocean for another part, because the Amazon River changed the water color and the coast. So the crew rescued the boat. And when they back to the station, they see a jaguar. Let's see. Yeah, it's small, but you can see in the medium of the video a jaguar. This jaguar is fishing for it. It's a rare comportment of this animal in the parts of the world. So the crew is can do this video to us. And so this is the school. It's an agroecological school in Brazil. It's a community school. It's not a public for the state, but we work with donation and we work with the participate in some funds, and some participate in a donation. It's the principal maintainment of this school. So you can see an image of the students we work in the boat. It's some image of the school, some image of Rhodolites is near to the school, and the community we work here too. So the name of the boat were chosen because the Kraken is a mythological name, and some students tell about the possible route used to the boat is the same route used by the Viking boats a century ago. So here in Amapá, we have a Stonehenge. We have a megalithic stone. It's the same we can see in Stonehenge. And the Sami students tell about that and choose the name for that and for our mythologic history about a gigant snake that lived and sleep above the cities and above the river. And when this snake wake up, the city and the Amazon rainforest go to the Bilon of the Amazon River and the ocean. I think so our relectory about our reading about the change of the level of the ocean and health ocean, I think so. So the mystical reading about the change of the level of the ocean and this history about the mythological condition, the student chose the name of the new name of the boat about this snake. It's Sophia snake, and using this image and this name to work to the boat in the next 2 weeks. We'll send the boat back to the ocean and hope this mini boat go to around the part of the world, think so Africa or come back to Europe. And that's it for all my presentation. Sorry for anything. I keep here just some image of the city, the megalithics and overview of the capital city of the state. And I invite everyone to know Amazon rainforest, knows Amapá, and thank you so much for your attention.
It's really good to hear the end of the story and your link to sea monsters. That's great. And yeah. It was so funny how the boat got stuck in that eddy right at the end. It made a really fast transit across the Atlantic and then the couple of eddies right at the end.
Yeah, the ideas and the help with the students can change our history.
Yeah. It also landed the same day that Paolo's boat was landing. The same day. So we were watching the boat go to Morocco and the other boat go to Brazil. There was a lot of text messages that day. Very exciting.
And come through the history about the three person stay between anyone in and part in the world.
Yeah. Three hops and we can connect everybody in the world. This is really interesting. Yeah. So we still have time, 8 minutes there. There are four questions now. Yeah, I will start by a question that I received from YouTube, from Emanuela Safo Senya. She has a question: When are the mini boats retrieved after being deployed into the ocean, and how do you retrieve the mini boats in the case where the GPS gets destroyed? I mean. So basically, if you leave the boat until they reach, the shore, or if not, how long it takes to retrieve the boat from the ocean? And also, if something happens with GPS, what can you do? So maybe, the question is open. Who wants to give a first stab?
Do you want me to try?
Yeah, Cassie, please.
So we have these new GPS transmitters that are using the Iridium network, and we are able to talk to them to change the reporting rate. So as they're getting closer to shore, we say, start telling us where you are every hour. But the sensor packs can report more frequently, up to, like 5-minute reports every 15 minutes. And that was really essential in recovering Kraken, as well as Tuga. And for the cases of the boats that the GPS stops, there's a sticker communication on top that says to call me. So actually for the Galway sailor, I received a call on July 18th from Norway. And I had known that it wasn't reporting. And I said, okay, if this is Norway, it has to be the Galway sailor. And it turns out it was Lars. And it was the boat.
Oh, that's interesting. You know, so we have another two questions from Edmir. And Edmir wants to talk. I'll include him as a panelist because he wants to ask you how he can start to collaborate with you. So, Edmir, can you? Edmir, can you open? Okay, he'll be rejoining as a panelist. Edmir, can you open your camera and your microphone and ask your two questions? Are you still there with us?
Oi, Moutinho.
Okay,
now I can speak.
Yeah, good, good.
I think the project is very, very beautiful and interesting. I have a question to Gabriel and to the other panelists. If the project includes other locations in the South Atlantic, it's possible to make a ser uma parceria, né? Desculpem pelo meu inglês, não é minha língua mãe, matriz.
Mas partnership, possible, yeah.
Yeah, it's possible to make a partnership with schools of the South and Southwest of Brazil. Because I think the project includes only schools of North Atlantic, and the North Pacific, but it's possible to make a partnership with schools in the South Atlantic. And I have another question. In the world, in the KA, you use algorithm to predict the trajectory of the mini boat, or it's a process, or use another process to predict the trajectory with the com os alunos, né, with the students. Eu não sei se eu consegui fazer entender, desculpe.
Yeah. So I think so the answer to question to the Moutinho is the first question. I think so the best answer to this question is the look, because the history begin with a partnership between the Air Center and our university. And after this, the boat come to us by luck, by wine, by anything. So to begin another partnership, I think so Cassie or Moutinho can talk better than me to this answer.
Yeah, maybe Cassie and Francisco.
I mean, from our side, this was this why there are only the European Atlantic, because mainly it was the limits of the of our project was the funded agency was the INTERREG Atlantic Area, that is covering the Atlantic regions in the in Europe. But of course, if we have in the future another project that is with a global scale, we could also think on that. But in the meantime, we don't have to wait probably for the funding. Maybe you can also talk with Cassie, because I mean, I think I don't know if this is the case, but it has been the first time in our case where we include this as a mini fleet in a project. Normally, I have heard of collaboration directly with educational facilities. So I think that this is an opportunity, but Cassie can give you more details.
Yeah, it's the first but not the last. The iFADO project actually inspired the POGO, the Partnership for Observation of the Global Ocean, to do the same thing. So they're actually going to be launching 4 mini boats in September off the Polar Stern, which will be going from the north to from Germany to Cape Town, South Africa. So yeah, as educational passengers, we want to get to as many schools and to people as we can, and hope to copy the model and grow the model from iFADO to achieve that.
Okay, so
if you want, I can take the modeling question.
Yes, please.
So basically, I just started and ended by testing a simple, very simple linear correlation between the actual trajectory and the wind components, and it worked amazingly well. And Cassie was saying, "What kind of magic are you using? Because so many people have done this, and so." But it got worse and worse as the time went. My idea is that if you have the sail perfectly aligned, perpendicular to the boat, it actually goes right with the wind. And in our region, we don't have very strong currents like the Gulf Stream or other types of very strong ocean currents. The challenging part, I think, is that if the sail gets not perpendicular to the hull and the other eventual difficulties on the drag. But in our case, I was just testing this linear, so I just fitted a linear correlation between the winds and the actual trajectory, and that these two tracks that I was showing, it was taking the old trajectory or only the past 3 days to compute this linear correlation between the actual trajectory and the wind speed. And obviously it all to the success of the modeling, it also will be very tightly connected with the quality of the winds, if the winds are actually the ones that are observed. But this is this subject of trying to predict the trajectory of the mini boats is by itself an excellent classroom activity with the kids with more age, obviously. But there's so many things that you can do with it. So thank you.
Yeah, and students themselves can use our path analysis tool, which has the mini boat tracks with the global forecast for winds, currents, and waves. So they can actually in the classroom track it, make their own predictions.
That's very interesting. Well, we are 1 minute beyond the hour, but Frank wants to ask a question about the sensors for biodiversity, always biodiversity with Frank.
Thank you very much. This is a fantastic presentation, fantastic project. Thank you very much. And I know that we don't have a lot of time, but I was wondering if you can put some simple, what are the limitations on putting sensors on the boats, including cameras above water and below water?
If I can jump in on the question. So I think the limitations could be many or no limitations. It's basically a question of space. And I'm just comparing with the glider and the water glider. So it's a small platform, but really, really capable. But of course, it depends on what you attempt to do in terms of endurance, basically, and the weight of size of this type of elements, so in terms of sensors or battery packs, so telemetry systems, the cameras. But I mean, there are many options in terms of, I will say, low cost from the positive part of the world. So there are many, many options in order to improve the capabilities for these small mini boats, these small platforms, but really, really powerful in many aspects. Mm-hmm. So then I think it's a question to identify the applications more than the if the technology exists or not. So I'm fully sure that the technology is there in some way, but it's just to identify the application and how to address these technology capabilities in order to cover partially or totally this application, getting the most from the Miniboat program. So I think there are many examples here from the presentations today, so that slowly and with a lot of interest and effort, so some additional capabilities has been added in the past launchings and programs, so from many of the partners. So I think it's a good it's a very good opportunity to try to cover some needs from the ecosystem approach and from these aspects, so in order to complement at least and at the end of the day the option observing needs and capabilities, putting together all those aspects. So
thank you.
So thank you all so much for this fascinating session. We will post this video, so people that was used to watch in the yes, I pass to you, Francisco. Don't worry, of course I'll pass to you. And so there will be opportunity to interact. And also Cassie just posted her email address, so you can contact her if you want to develop some projects. This Edmir is for you specifically. And so I pass the floor to Francisco. So Francisco can close the session.
Thank you very much. Just for adding some remarks. As you can see here, each story is unique and it has been very exciting for all of us, even including the Earth Center, and putting contact people that didn't know each other to try to rescue the boat and the mini boat. And then we have a very nice story of what will happen next. But also it's very interesting I would like to thank especially all the researchers being involved, because they have to do a lot of effort out of their area of comfort. That is like going to the schools, talking to very different people, networking with other projects. This type of activity has made a lot of networking with the many, many people involved. You can see that also in the acknowledgement from them, there are research cruises, other projects, other funding involved, people supporting each other. So I think it's a very nice and enlarging story. And also I would like to thank you, especially that for the teachers and the students, that also is something challenging for them. And I know that we don't have today many of them, because I would like to thank you especially, but we are normally, we are now on, or mostly all of them in the school holidays, so it's difficult to have them here. But I think it is an exciting way also to tell them about the current. It's more interesting than just a graph, but to imagine where their boat will go. So I think it's very, very exciting. And also to encourage you to follow the iFADO project social media, because we are updating all the time the adventures for the mini boats that are currently at sea, or that they will be released again. And the last one that will be also released. So you want to track what will happen with this mini boat, please, if you go to the website of ifado.eu, you can find the social media there. And normally we are updating with news and new events that are unexpected, even for all of us. So that's it. And thank you very much for the center for the support with the mini boat that helped us, especially for this last one in Brazil. And also for having us today here and so we can tell this story.
That was a really funny story to tell my grandchildren.
That was amazing, especially with the video of the jaguar. I saw yes. It to all my colleagues. That was amazing thing to show to everyone.
And also in Morocco,
you do a payment to the jaguar.
Yeah. Well, yeah, we should make a special thanks to him. Yeah, or no, her, I don't know. No.
And Marian from Morocco, that was also very interesting. They're all there, they participate. I'm so happy they could join us. So before closing, I'd like to give a special thanks for Tanya, that Tanya is always, and Catarina, Catarina is also over here, they're always behind the networking threads, they never appear. So I don't know if they're still there, but thank you, Tanya, so much for opening the session today, and to Catarina for always supporting the networking Fridays. Thanks for Frank to be here and to you all. So see you next Friday, okay? Bye-bye.
Bye, thank you.
Bye.
All right.
Bye, see you.
So thank you, Mohammed.